Chad, good to see you. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
So you got this op-ed out. Biden's administration military recruiting and retention crisis is a self-inflicted wound. Here's how to reverse course. So let's start at the first part of what you're saying. I mentioned before you got on, Army, Navy, Air Force all missed their recruiting goals. Army is at their smallest man end strength since the 1940s. Let's just start with the first part of the premise in this op-ed. You said it's a self-inflicted wound. What have they done to inflict the wound that is causing this?
Well, you remember why young men and women joined the military. They're young patriots who want to serve our nation and protect our national security. And they're not interested in joining the military for woke policies and these type of things that are being pushed on them. They want to go train to be warfighters. The COVID vaccine kept many of our service members out of the field, out of training, and all these young men and women that want to reenlist to do their job that they raised a hand to do, they just were not incentivized to do it. So not only did they get hurt on the recruiting side, but they were hurt with the reenlistment side and just seeing a very large reduction in reenlistment. Now, I think the recruiting overall right now, we're at a 30% reduction in recruiting as per two years prior. That's the lowest since Vietnam. And the recruiters are struggling with the number that we don't really see that's more scary than me to anything else, is that these considerations of being 30% down, that's considering that they've drastically reduced two things that impact our national security. One is the reduction in size. So we've shrank, our military is shrinking, they're reducing numbers. And so they're still, even with that 30%, that's based on reduced numbers. And secondly, is the reduction of quality. I go all around the nation and speak to our active duty troops. And one of the things that these commanders are dealing with there is a reduction in quality, lowering standards for the entry into the military.
Yeah,
and
speak to that just for a second, because it's not just, what are the, for people who don't know, talk to me about what are the standards that have gone down? On what side of the coin, if you will?
Well, I mean, when you join the military, it's just like getting a job anywhere else. There's a background check. You have to be interviewed. You have to meet certain physical fitness requirements. Your background has to be, pretty, to get in the military, it should be pretty clean. You should have a pretty clean record as far as criminal activity. The academic standard, you take what's called the ASVAB test, and that qualifies you for different jobs. All those things are being lowered, including criminal activity. And it was very hard. Just 2-3 years ago, it's very difficult to get in the military. Demand to get in the military was high, and now we're seeing that reduction in interest in being in the military. So they have to lower the standards in order to get people.
And yeah, I noticed that the physical standards have also started to take a hit. You see more and more people getting waivers to come in for health and physical related issues.
Yeah, I mean, down at Marine Corps boot camp, the recruits are getting sent down there because the recruiters are lowering their standards. And then now the drill instructors have to deal with getting these kids in shape. That it's not a goal that, the Marine Corps boot camp is 13 weeks. They have 13 weeks to get someone that can't do a pull-up up to, being able to do a minimum of 5, a maximum of 22. That's putting a job on the recruit, on the drill instructors, that's just unattainable. And so these kids are entering the fleet and the Marine Corps and all the other branches of service, just not quite ready to do the job that our nation needs them to do. Let's not forget what the military does.
Right.
I think we forget sometimes what the military actually does. It's to fight off our enemies, foreign and domestic, and make sure that America's safe and protect our national security. So we want the most physically fit, most mentally sharp warriors that we can have on the battlefield.
It's funny. I always tell people it's not a social experiment. We're not here. This is not an HR company where we're trying to figure out how to. It's literally, as you put it, to defend the country from enemies, foreign and domestic. To people, when we face threats, the military answers the call. You're under a system of justice, the Uniform Code of Military Justice. You don't have the right to go, yeah, tomorrow doesn't work, Tuesday's not that good for me. That's what you're signing up for. You miss holidays and birthdays. You go on deployments. That's what you've signed up for. It's not a social experiment. And I think too many people, especially those who haven't served, don't fully appreciate that you're not joining this thing. There's physical standards, there's academic standards, there are lifestyle standards that you can and cannot do certain things. as a military member versus a civilian, but you've willingly chosen that.
Yeah. And then look, you have to consider too, the mental health of, when you don't have mental and spiritual readiness to go out and do that war fighting, like a lot of these people that we see in the military right now have, there's going to be repercussions to that. And, if you're not fit, physically, mentally, spiritually to do that job, there's going to be repercussions to that. And at Mighty Oaks Foundation, that's what we do. We help people in the back end. Our VA has proven it's not capable of doing that job. You know, thankfully, there's VSOs, veteran service organizations like Mighty Oaks in the back end. But, you know, it's going to be much worse when we're putting people in that aren't mentally and physically, spiritually resilient.
You know, it's funny. I mean, you look at the world that we face now, and you addressed a little of this in your op-ed, but the bottom line is between what's happening in Ukraine, Iran being provocative, North Korea being provocative, China clearly being provocative, you would think from a military standpoint, we would want to be upping the requirements, making sure that our folks are better trained, are better equipped, are more ready. And yet we're going in the opposite direction. I don't know that sends the strongest signal to our adversaries.
No, it doesn't. Well, I mean, you're right, but you're right from the perspective of you care about winning. We have to care about winning first.
That's right.
And I know I'm not sure that we have an administration right now that cares about winning. They just care about.
Is it just the administration, Chad, or do you think the American? I mean, there's days when I feel like, you know, getting back to my point about social experiment. I wonder if people, especially a lot of folks on the left these days, fully appreciate that without freedom. I look at the number of people who are siding with Hamas now in America, and I'm thinking to myself, I see these signs, queers for Hamas, and I'm thinking, dummy, there's no such thing as queers for Hamas. They'll kill you. I don't think that people fully appreciate the freedoms that they have in this country, the role the military has in protecting it and advancing that freedom around the globe.
No, you're right. You know, there's the saying that strong men create a weak society, and weak society creates strong men, and you know the cycle that goes around. Right now, I think we coming out of a cycle that we had some strong men that created a weak society, and now these weak people are making decisions for this country that puts us in a jeopardizing position. Our young men and women that are around the world right now are definitely in places that they probably shouldn't be. Doing things that we shouldn't be involved in, and we've lost the trust. I think the military culture and the historical military culture has lost the trust in the direction that we're going to go militarily. And so the repercussion of that is seeing these generational families that participate in the military. For example, my family has 84 years of service. Now, both my sons are Marines. One of them is still serving. But I have so many friends, particularly in the special operations community, that have multi-generational families serving in those communities that won't encourage their sons to enlist. I have a friend right now who's a third generation SEAL. He trained his son his whole life to be a SEAL. He's ready to go. And he's like, they called it off. They're like, I just don't have the confidence to put my son in that position.